Right here we have our pitch bend wheel. Now this transmits MIDI pitch bend information on a select MIDI channel or port. So this is pitch bend. Next one here we have our modulation wheel. So this is our mod wheel. Now this wheel can be used sort of like to, you know, transmit continuous controller data. Now by default, this modulation wheel will transmit MIDI CC number 1. Now here we have our pad bank buttons. There's A, B, C, and D. Now these correspond to our pad bank. So we got 12 here, 12 on B, 12 on C, 12 on D. So we get a full 48 different sounds we can access through our pad bank buttons. Here is our full level. Now when this button is lit, this means the pads in our pad bank, we hit a pad, will play at the full velocity, the maximum peak level for that particular sound that the pad's going to trigger. And all the pads will act that way. So this is a full level for every pad in the pad bank. Our next button here is our 12 levels. Now what this button does, it activates all 12 pads to a velocity of different levels. Now it's all mapped out according to the last pad hit. So if we hit a pad, and then we've got this, we go hit the pad, turn it on, and we've got 12 levels on, that means we have 12 different velocity levels for each pad. Now in your manual, you'll see a little chart, and the chart will show you what each pad's velocity would be. Here we have our arpeggiator button. And this button sort of enables you to turn it on and turn it off. Now what it does is that the arpeggiator will function on notes being played in the keyboard. So we're playing stuff on the keyboard, and then it can arpeggiate. So we play a chord, and it'll arpeggiate that chord. You know, play one note at a time. But it'll do it according to the tempo and the time division setting, where it's quarter notes, eighth notes. Except for that, it'll do it to quarter notes, eighth notes, providing it set to the proper tempo, I guess. And so what happens then is that you hold this down, the right tempo, and you're good to go. And it'll play. Now this is all done in our setup. And it works primarily with an external MIDI clock source, like with a digital audio workstation or a MIDI device. Now here we have our latch button. So turn the arpeggiator on, and the latch button goes on. See that? If your arpeggiator is off, then the latch goes off. So they work together. We hold the arpeggiator button down, and then we latch. Now what happens here is that this button works in conjunction with the arpeggiator. So when your arpeggiator is turned on, the latch button goes on, and enables you to hold down several combinations of keys. And the arpeggiator will memorize those keys and continue to arpeggiate those keys. Even if you depress another key, it'll keep doing that same, those specific keys, like 1, 2, 3, these keys here are going to play. No matter what you touch on the keyboard, it's going to keep playing those keys. Now, while holding down the keys, you can add more notes to the sequence by pressing down additional keys. And if you press or depress the keys and release them, then press down a new combination of keys, the arpeggiator will memorize the new notes. And this works playing the same principle in a sense where if we have a tempo set and a time division, quarter notes, eighth notes, 16 notes, 32nd notes, and we hit this button and we hold a pad down, then that pad will react. It means it will repeat that note according to whatever the subdivision is and what the tempo is. Here we have our pad banks. These pad banks, and they have the feel and the look just like the MPC 500, and they are the same. Now what happens to these pad banks? It's like pretty simple stuff. There are 12, of course, they are pressure and velocity sensitive pads, so you can hit them hard, hit them soft, and of course the machine will recognize how hard or how soft you're hitting them. Or if, unless you have like your full level button on, then it's the same velocity each time you hit the pad. And what happens here, of course, you can trigger hits, you can have drum sounds or samples on your software, or you get say on your hardware too as well. A module, say for example, a trigger sound, maybe on this machine, you can trigger it from here also as well. And these are pretty cool sensitive pads, and they work really great. Love them. Here we have our LCD display. Obviously, it's pretty cool. I keep my plastic on. I like to preserve it in case, you never know, you may want to sell it one day, get the new one or whatever comes out. It always looks good. I keep the plastic on it. It always keeps it fresh, never gets scarred. Preset button. Now this button calls up preset mode. You can select and recall different preset programs in this mode. You may have certain programs for certain softwares like Reasons or Live Light, and so you may want to call it up, press the button, call up that program. And you can have up to 30 different presets. And right here we have our edit button. Press this edit button, and this button calls up edit mode, which allows us to edit the behavior of the keyboard or the pads or the knobs or the buttons. We just turn the knobs and buttons, set a particular edit we want to do, and we do it by pressing the edit button. Here we have our global button. This button calls up global mode. Now in global mode, we can sort of reset MIDI commands and global system preferences. And they're all set right here in global mode. Now here we have our preview button. It's a great button to have. And it's really cool. It should be on more instruments. This preview button allows you to see what value you have set by the controller, with a slider or a knob. And what this allows you to do, it gives you the precise control over that parameter and helps you avoid erroneous controller data being sent. So I mean, sometimes the slider could be someplace else or it's down somewhere, and then you actually start doing something. You want to say, wait a minute, I don't want it to be there. You want to check. You hold down preview and you can check and make sure the data going from that slider being sent through your MIDI port is correct. Now here we have our program change button. And when pressing this button, it will enter the program change mode. And in this mode, you can send a program change or a program with bank change message to your hardware or your software. It's a program change button right there. Okay, next here we've got our transport section. That's going backwards, forwards. This is our stop, our play, and our record buttons. Now these five buttons are transport control buttons, and the five buttons are sort of dedicated, you know, for sending transport and control commands. And the transport and control buttons can be set to transmit MMC, which is MIDI machine control. So it tells the machine, okay, we're going to start here. We'll tell the machine, let's start. Okay, press the play button, it's going to start. We'll tell the machine, we're going to stop. So it's controlling the other machines through MMC. And we can also do it with a pre-assigned MIDI CC level as well. 1, 2, 3, 4. Just tap that sucker right in there, of course. We're tapping a tempo in. Now the tap tempo button allows you to tap a new tempo. If the preset is reloaded, the tempo will revert to the save tempo value. So you got to note that the preset's default tempo can be set in the edit mode. That's important to know. And tap tempo does not work when your MPK49 is set to external sequencer. That means the external sync's going to control it. This will not be the controller, another machine will be the controller. Now our next button here is our control bank button. This is a very important button on our MPK49. Now this button has three features in a sense. What happens here is that this button, you press it one time, we got A bank. You press it again, we got B bank. You press it one more time, we got C bank, giving us access to 72 independent parameters that work with our knobs, our faders, and our buttons on our MPK49. And the control bank button is used to switch between all three banks, you know, from A, B, to C. And so you get each bank, this one, that one, this one, and you control the buttons and all the sliders and faders, everything else. It's really cool. Great way for us to control the parameters in our MPK49. Now here we have our value buttons. And these value buttons up here, and this is down. And this button also acts as a cancel as well. And we can push this button to enter the value. Got that? Up and down. I get a value in there. We entered it. I'm going to cancel it. I just cancel that value. That's how it works. Okay, next here we've got our time division button. Now this button is used to specify the rate of the note repeat and the arpeggio, the features we talked about earlier. So you press this button down, we want quarter notes. We press this here, we're doing quarter notes. We want to do quarter note triplets. We'll press S2 down, we got quarter note triplets. We want to do eighth notes. Press this down. See, this button's activated. We're activated now. We're ready to roll. We're setting up what we want to use for our time division, with quarter notes all the way to 32nd note triplets. Now, got to note this for sure. This is from the manual. Please note that while the time division is active, the eight assignable buttons will not function as MIDI, CC, or program chain switches until the time division button has been deactivated. Remember that. So here we're doing time division. I can go here, see what happens. S3 will light up. And this is the quarter note. And right here we can do 32nd note. I'm going to do 16ths or the 32nd note triplets, 16th note, 16th note triplets, 8th note triplets, 8th notes. So our time division is set. And now we deactivated the time division. Now here we have our octave key right here. The down and the up, the reset for the octaves. Now our MPK has four octaves physically. It's 49 keys, so we have four octaves. But we also can access the bottom half and do a -3. So we go down -3 octaves. And we can go up +3 octaves, giving us a range of 10 octaves. It's really great. Now next up we have our assignable sliders. Now each slider can be used to send continuous control data to our desktop audio workstation if you're using like Reasons or using Go Light. You can send continuous data to those softwares. And also with the MIDI device as well. This is the back of our MPK49. Right here we've got a expression pedal input. We got our sustain pedal input, MIDI in, MIDI out, and our USB. That's how we power up our machine. Or if you got it, you can put your 7-volt DC power unit right in there. Of course, our lock, and we're good to go. Let's check the machine out now. Now, before we even start with MPK49, it's important to make sure your cables are plugged in. So what we're doing here is that we make sure we got our cable. See? And here's our cable for MPK49. It's on the backwards. But you make sure that your cable connection is secure, it's in tight, and it's plugged in there right the way you want to have it plugged in. Make sure that you have a really good connection. And then the other end will go into my computer system, and there, we got power. Now, once you got this on, and you got some power, and you're ready to go, then you can turn on or load up your application, whether it's Reasons or Pro Tools or Sonar or Cubase or Go Live or this Live Light that Live made for the Akai MPK49. Make sure your keyboard controller is set up, it's plugged into your computer, and then launch the application that you're going to use with your MPK. So we've got our MPK49 by Kyle hooked up here. We have right here, we've got our USB cable plugged into our MPK49. And now I'm going to plug the other end into my computer using a MacBook. Very simple, but a great machine to use right now. I'm going to plug it in. And now the MacBook is supplying power to our Akai MPK49, obviously. Because the power is on and our display is functioning right there. Now it shows us our first preset. And in our MPK49, we can have up to 30 presets. You can turn your little button right over here, which is our little, let me move that a little bit here, you'll see it better. I'll turn my knob right here, see that? And we turn it one space there for our value knob, and we've got Reasons. And this is the Reasons presets right here. These are all the Reasons presets. This is the Cubase preset. This is the Sonar preset. This is the applied acoustics preset. So there are a lot of presets. This is the expander BFD. It's a cool software I use once in a while. There are a lot of presets in the system itself. This is Expander Guru. This is G Media. Rod Pappin. This has got some great synths right there. So these are all presets. And then once you get past this one here, Versin, we get here to General MIDI. These are all general presets they have here. This is drums. These are generic right here, all generic. And so up to 30 different presets we can install and put into our MPK49. Now, this is our reasons preset. If you want to load a preset, we can say, okay, this is a preset we want to load, and it says enter to load. Well, to enter, we just press this button down. And now, reasons is loaded up. This is the reasons preset. Let's say I use this preset already. I'm going to go to back to my original preset or another preset or even create a preset. I would just say turn the dial. This is Live Light 1. I'll press the enter button here. And now we're back to Live Light. That's how we can get back and forth from one preset to the next. If you're using, say, Reasons and other software or whatever software you're using, you can have a preset installed, set up your parameters for that preset, and save it. We can save up to 30 different presets in our MPK49. Once you set up in a particular preset or whatever, when we're playing a keyboard, and we're playing the keyboard parts here on our MPK, the display will display the octave where we're set at. Here's an octave. I'm going to go octave up. Up again. Up again. Up again. See that? Some sort of delay on there, obviously. And so we can change the octave. And when playing a keyboard, we're actually going to display just that. We'll zoom a little bit so you can see that information. And you'll see it right here. See? And so we see the octave display right there. It's pretty obvious. So, octave. And this is our transport right here. What's going on with transport? You know, I can press play, you see that it goes right into that. I can press back to the keyboard, and we're right back to the octave display. And so what happens is that we can see the octave and the transpose right there when we're playing the keyboard. Now, when I hit a pad, hold this pad, hit that pad again, hit this pad, any pad I want to hit, I hit those pads, then we can see other information. For example, here we'll see the MIDI channel. So there's MIDI channel right there, that's MIDI channel A, that's 1A, and we'll see the note displayed right here. This is 041, that's 38, 41, 44, 47. So these are the MIDI notes. Now here, we have the velocity. That's how hard I hit the actual pad. Now you see here, we have these little lines going up here. This sort of gives me an idea, a visual display of how hard I hit the pads, whether hard or soft or not. And you can see how this lights up even more. The lines get wider and longer the harder I hit the pad. Now right here we have the data. This is the data for the aftertouch. I hold this down here, and that's, see that? After I hit it, that's the aftertouch right there. And displays the aftertouch data right there. Now what also can happen here is that if we move a knob, turn a knob, we'll see the changes. We'll see what the control data, for example, it says 02, and that says 67. If I move a slider, it says Control 12, that's the data, I moved it to data 024. And of course, it's the MIDI channel again. So by moving these knobs and sliders, we can change control data. So I can turn this knob here, turn this one here, move the slider up here, up and down. As I move these things up and down, what happens is that they change here on our screen. So we'll change the
control, which is the control axis. This is what the control is. That particular knob, like this knob here, which is K1, comes up as O2. K2 comes up as O3 control. And there's the data that I changed. It's 36 there. I can change this knob. And now it's controller O2 changed this data to 085.
And these are control changes. We're going to do more of this when we actually start to edit up some presets. And we're going to edit up the presets using the knobs and the sliders. I'm using reasons here. Let me span out a little bit more here. And if I press play, we're sending out MMC. It's in the preset already, right here on the MPK. I'll press stop. So we're controlling it through, this is the external controller. And so it's controlling that software. You can also control a module, like a sound module, like a rack mount motif or a rack mount Triton, or any rack mount. You can control that using our reason. Provided they have a sequencer built into them, we can control them, and we control the parameters also as well. If we even have sequences in there, we use a software to sequence and an output, and we can at least control the parameters through our MPK49. Now, once I've held this preview button down, I will see a few things here. I'll see the control. This is the control we're going to have, which means, of course, one of these controllers, which could be, I'm hitting the using the fader 1. I can go to fader K here. Pull the control down. This is 2. This is 12. See the control changes. The next thing, this is the last data. This is the last data that this was set to. So that means 12, control 12, was set to 57. This is the new data that would take its place. So it wouldn't be 57, it would be 45. So I'll see the preview. What's at the particular control change, what the data is, and I can set the new data for it. So it's going to 12, I want to set it maybe to 57, I'm going to put it to 68. So now that means that the control 12 will be 68, not 57. This is a great way to make sure you've got the proper data for that particular controller set up. I can release it now. I can move this wheel, this little F1 again, press preview down again, and I see it's actually in sync with the last and the first. So what happens is that it helps us to actually get the right control data that we want to have. In case you got a problem, you can hit the preview. It won't send any data out. You can select the right data you want to send out, then lift it off, and then you can change whatever control you'd like to change. Now, for example, that'll work here in this case. I can press preview, and I've got a control change here. I see it could be saying 71, which says 55. I want to set it to here. That's what I want to keep it. Release this, and when I use this again for that particular amount of data, it'll show up as where it was left last. That means that that 71 I set now will appear as the last bit of data change made to the control change parameter 13. I'm going to go over a few things here dealing with modes. First mode, of course, is our preset mode. Here, we can have up to 30 different presets, and we can change them. So we go to presets here, and we can select the preset we want to select. We'll just, of course, turn our data wheel, find the preset we want, and we can press enter, and we're in with that preset. Here we have our edit mode. This allows us to edit information in the preset. So this mode allows you to edit the configuration of your MPK49. Edit mode is like a really cool way for you to change the whole entire setup. What happens is that in this mode, you can make changes to how the keyboard pads, how the knobs, how the sliders are all behaving. For example, if I wish to have a slider knob transmit a limited number of data, I can say, well, wait, I don't want this to do but so much, and this can do but so much here. Move this here to that, then press enter, and I've got it. So that means I've changed the data. I'm going to change the data here on one of these things, or change the data on a pad somewhere. Okay, this data this goes here. My data changes. I said, okay, great. Well, that's how we can change the setup on our MPK49 using our edit. There's our global, of course. We can go through many of the different global commands and global. We've just showed you preview. We have preview, and we have program change. Now here in program change,
I can change certain banks of sounds, let's say another sequencer. I have a module hooked up to my MPK49, and I want to use the bass sounds in the other bank or the other program. I'll just go to here, tell what program I'm going to do. I'll say I'm going to do this program here. I'm going to change the program. I'll pick the bank or the program I'm going to change. I'll press enter, and that information will be changed, and it will tell that machine to play the banks. This makes it easier rather than having to go over to the module and to physically change the settings on the module. I can do it from the MPK49. Okay, now I've got the power on and ready to go, and we've launched application Reasons. The next thing I want to do is probably set up my preset, get the preset I want to use with my Reasons software. Here's how it works. First thing we want to do is we want to press the preset button. Now, let's make sure that we're ready to start doing our preset thing. We're going to go back here, and now we're going to rotate our knob here. See this one here? So go one space, and here I am in Reasons. And see, we see Reasons right there. It says Enter ENT to load. So I'll press the Enter button right here. And now, we've loaded the Reasons preset. You can see there's number 2. That's 2 right here, and this is Reasons. Now, next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to press Edit. I'll press Edit right here. Now, once I press Edit, I'll press Play. So now we're playing the software in Reasons. And I'll press Stop. So now I have my preset selection all made up there. We already know it's MMC/MIDI Machine Control. I'll press this down, and you see it's right there. It's set up in this setting. And I'm good to go. So I know that this is already set to go. Of course, I can press play here. At the top. I'll go up here. So I'm controlling the software through my MPK49. Okay, now I'm going to talk about preset and preset mode. Now we can do in presets and preset mode, we can actually load the preset. That's obvious, right? We go here to preset, we load the preset in. I got a Reasons preset set up right here, right now. I can go to my preset, I want to load, I press this 2 here, I'm going there, I'm going to press that, I'm going to go to 1, that's light, that's live light. Okay, that's loaded in. I can also save a preset. Let's say I got a preset here, I make some changes, I play, this says like 3 octaves up, I want to bring it back down. That's 0. We're at the regular octave range for the keyboards. But I want to save it now. So I'll say, okay, when I save this, I got my preset there. I'm going to go to here, and I press the right arrow. And here I can save it. I can save it to 1. Now if I press yes, it'll save it right there. See that? I'm saved. I can hit the keyboard again. The octave's right there again. Not where it was before. What I can also do is I can say, well, I want to change it again. I want to change the octave range up higher. So now it's higher. Now, I want to save it again. I'm going to press save. But I want to save it someplace different. So, here's what we do. So now that I want to save it, I'll just turn my value knob. And I can select where I want to change it to. And where I want to save this actual program. Now you'll notice too also that if I'm in the place where it originated from, this says save to. So light 1 or live light is in preset 1. It says save to 01. So it's going to save to itself. I turn the data wheel here for the value knob. And you'll see here now it says copy. So if you're not going to save it to the original location, then you're going to copy to someplace else different. Now here, I want to maybe put it here at 30, we'll say. And I'll press enter. And now you'll see here, this says 30. And this is live light. And so I have a new preset saved there, which is my new preset called Live Light, and it's in preset 30. So this is how you can actually save presets, you know, make it a different configuration, like what you got, you want to keep it. Well, we want to find a space for it, we get a blank space hopefully, and we store that preset there. So I stored my preset, I got it there, I like the preset, hey, I want to keep this preset right there, it's kind of cool. It's preset 30, but I want to change a name. I want to give it a new name, so I can go to the cursor data. Right here, my cursor button right there, and I'm going to go here and press it once, twice, and now I can say the name. And you'll see that this first letter here, which is L, is blinking. And that's the one I can change. See? And I can move the cursor again. And the next one changes. And see? Capitals are there. And the lower cases are below that. And you can pick the name you want to get for your particular program. You change it, and you got it going on. This is a cool way to actually change everything, really. I can change it, and if I like it, change the name. I can say save. So I press that button down there, and I go like, yeah, we'll save it. And now here we go. So we light. See that? And that's how we can change the name of our preset. So here I am, we are in this preset here, which is when I saved earlier. And now I can go to here and see when I edit something here. I can edit anything I want to edit in this particular preset. Now, here's how it works pretty much. Let's go back a little bit here. If I move a slider, then the slider information comes up. You'll see it right here. Information comes up right there. We see the slider information right there. And now what I want to do, I move the slider. We get some information here. I see that I can change. For example, right here, I have control change. That's F1 slider. Now, you see that? I move back here. I can turn this dial. F1 slider has several control changes I can use. I can change the aftertouch and the control change. Now, if I go over here and I move this K1, we'll see here that it says K1. And I can control change, turn the drive wheel. I have aftertouch also. And I have increase and decrease. So I can change three different items here. Now, if I hit a pad, we'll say, and we hit this pad, and we'll see here that we have note. And we'll have program change. That's all we have there is note and program change for that pad. That's pad number 12. Now, once I see those properties, for example, I see, okay, I got my pad 12. I know I can do a program change, and I can also do a note change. See that? Program and note. I can say, well, I'm doing a note change. So I'll press the enter. And now I see the parameter. I can change. It says MIDI channel 3, and we can change the note, which is 78. I can change the note. I can press enter. It's good to go. We're back to note. I can hit this pad here. I want to do maybe a program change. I'll press the enter button, and now I have a control change right here. See, it's MIDI control change. And it's program change there. Here's the bank. And here's the bank L and the bank M. See that right there? I can change that data. I'll change it here. Back and forth. See that? I can go to whichever bank right there. Back again. Or change the data. Let the program change read this. I can press enter. And it's changed. That's what would be like, for example, I'm going to go to a pad here again, we'll say. And I want to change note. I'll press enter. And then that page 2 comes up. You notice that's page 2 of this edit mode. And here in page 2, I can change any parameter. Once it's entered again, we're back to page 1 of the edit mode. Now, the edit mode also works for keyboards. You press the keyboard here, it says set keyboard. Hit a pad. That's P3 for pad, K1 for the knob, F1 for the fader, S2 for the S buttons. Hit a keyboard, and I can change the octave, aftertouch, the velocity. it's going to change three different parameters here. Now, velocity, right after touch even, octave, I can go to here to enter. It's up to, I want to bring it down. So I'm going to bring this down. And I press my octave. That's good. I want to have it there. And now I'll press enter, and I'm good to go. And that's edit mode with the keyboard. So the keyboard also, you can also manipulate the parameters on the keys in the keyboard section. Now, one more thing I want to say too, we can do this for anything pretty much on the machine. For example, we're for edit mode and we do the mod wheel. I change this wheel here. I go back to edit mode. It's there. I go to here. I change this wheel here. These are wheel sets. This is the mod wheel. This is the pitch bend. We'll see this say, this says pitch bend. So in edit mode, we can change anything on our entire keyboard. We can change everything on the entire keyboard that we use to manipulate sound, whether it's the mod wheel, the pads, or the keyboards right here, or it's these buttons here. They appear here in the monitor screen, right there. And once they appear there, you can see what changes you can make to that particular item. Okay, so in the keyboard edit, I can press any key. I'll go to edit, I'll press a key, and now I'm here in the keyboard set. Now I'll press enter, which will press enter now, and right now you can see what's blinking here is the CC. I can change the MIDI channel there. I can go A to B, 16, all the way back down to CC control. Then I can move over here. We have velocity on or off. Turn the data wheel on or off. I can press enter. And then I can select the aftertouch. I'll press enter again. I can change the MIDI channel here and the aftertouch on or off also as well. And I can press enter. That's good information, we'll say. And I can see the prem. I can change velocity. I can change also as well. I can press enter. I'll change the velocity on or off. As you can see there, it's either on or off with velocity. So we can change the keyboard settings also. Now here we are. So I'll go back to the top again. Let's go back to preset. I'll press edit. And I'm hit a pad. This is pad number 6. So let's back out a little bit here. I'm hitting pad number 6 right there. And you see that set, pad 6 set. And this is note information. So I can select whatever parameter I want to edit. I can edit note and I can edit program change. So we'll do note. I'll press this down. And now we're there. As you can see, it's transmitting on port A3. Now here's port A3. I can change that, of course. Turning my data wheel here. I can make it CC on a common control MIDI channel. Or 1A. I can use it to two different ports, A or B. And I have 16 different channels, either one of those ports. In this case, it's already set to 3. Then here, next parameter I can change the note. Now right now, this is that note there with the 69. Now I'm also hitting the bank button. So you can hit a bank button right here for A, B, C, or D, and I'm changing the bank, which bank we're actually configuring. So here I'm going to go back to B. I was in B. And the note information here is for this particular pad, of course, which was pad number 6. And that's the note information right there. Now we can also change it here for MTY and toggle. And this is momentary. And then this is toggle. Now, when I go to momentary, MTY, the keyboard, or this pad acts the way it normally acts. I'm hitting that pad. I hit the pad. It plays the note, which apparently is 69. Note 69 on our keyboard range. And then I let the pad go, the note stops playing. So it's a hit and release thing. Now, when I go to toggle, the first hit of that pad engages the note. So it releases the note. I hit the pad. We're playing that note. The second hit cuts it off. And that's how toggle works. So the first hit turns the note on. It's playing the note. The second hit cuts the note off. And momentary, I hit it. It's playing. I remove my hand and release it. It stops playing that particular note. And next, I'll set the next field. The next field here is somewhat similar, except it just commands it in a sense where, turn the data wheel here, it's off. So that means whatever's going on here is not going to happen because it turned this command off. This one engages the command again, the CPR, and it's the PPR. Okay, now that was note for the pads. Okay, there's pad 6, of course, again. I can also do program change. Note or program change. I'll do program change now. I'll press the enter button. And here we do the same thing, actually. I'll move the cursor button back here. And you see here we have the MIDI channel. So we can send this data through the MIDI channel for the program change, whether it's from 1 through 16 in bank A or 1 through 16 in bank B. Or this common channel. Cursor button again. And now we can select the program, which could be a bank of sounds I want to access. Okay, hit the pad. I want you to hit that pad. Hit that pad. It sends this information out and tells whatever, let's say, module I have on another machine that I want you to play this program, this bank of sounds. And we'll say, okay, you want to do that. And so I can select the bank that I want to use, or the program I want to use in that particular keyboard module, we'll say. I can also select the most amount of data here I can send, as you can see here. See that? Or I can make it off. I can go here to the least amount of bit data here. It's on or off, see that? But I have to have the first one on, then go to this one, and I can send that one up. It has to do with bank data, and for the least amount of data and the most amount of data. Read your manual to understand how this works. But generally, if you're not going to use that stuff, you're not really programming a lot of data into your system, you can just make the pad trigger just the program change. Hit that pad, and that particular change happens within that module that you're sending the data through, which will be sending it through this port here. Okay, next I want to do changes for faders. I'm going to go here, of course, and move a fader. That's fader 1, it's fader 2. I think I'll move fader 2. And see, it's F2, right? That's F2. Perfect. So now we got F2. So we can do program change or aftertouch. I'll do program change. I'll press the enter button. And now you see the same thing again. You see right here, we've got the MIDI channel that we can transmit on. That's MIDI channel 1A. Or we can do the CC, control change, common MIDI channel. Specific MIDI channels 1A, 1 through 16, and B, 1 through 16 as well. Okay? And then over here, of course, as you can see here, for that fader we have here, it's set here. And this is the controller, 13. And that's that fader number 2. Then, here we have a max and minimum for the parameter. This parameter could be like, you know, portamento, some sort of, let's see, you know, I'd be using some sort of device that you can blow into and change the sound setting, or it could be the setting for the velocity, or whatever it's set for, this is set for, that's the change that it will affect that particular parameter that control 13 is set for. Now here, move the cursor over, I can change that control information, of course. And cursor over again, this is the amount that that change can happen from the minimum 0 to a maximum of 27. So that's my minimum 0, or I can make my 0 a minimum of, let's say, 22. That means when that fader goes down to 22. Let's see, it goes all the way down to here. That's 22. That's not zero. Up to there is 127. That's how that works. I can say, yeah, I'll enter that in. Or I can say, I don't want that. I can go back to here, turn in my value wheel, then move the cursor over to 127, turn the wheel down again. I can say I want it to be 99, 98. I'll put it at 99. See, that's good. I can press enter, and that change has been made. That's failure number two. Now, what happens here with failure number two? My preset. And we'll see now. When I take that fader, go to bottom at zero, the top is 99. So see that? This fader right here, the bottom there is zero. The top is 99. That's my top. That's my bottom. So I've changed the amount of the parameter. So I'd say probably 099, but not from zero to 127. Now the same thing can happen with a fader or up knob is I can go to edit, click my knob now, and I might want to do aftertouch. I'll do my fader one. I can do aftertouch. I'll press enter, and we have aftertouch. Now see, it starts off right here on these minimum and the maximum. I can move the cursor over a couple times here. And here we are on CC again for our MIDI channel. That's CC, common control. I continue, of course, to either port or whatever channel on that port I want to use. With the cursor again, it just skips over after because we know it's aftertouch. And then we can set the parameter for aftertouch for that particular fader. I can set it right there. I can go here and say, okay, I want to make it this or that. Set it for that. Press enter, and it's set for aftertouch on fader 2. That's how we can set the aftertouch level for that particular fader or any fader in the edit mode. Now, the same thing happens here for knobs. Knobs are different, though. I can press edit and select the knob I want. Here's K1, K2, up to K8, and here in K8, I can press enter. And here, of course, the same thing here, where we're sending the information. Information is going out, what port and what channel on that port are we sending it to. And, of course, you have our controller right here, control change information right there. And we also have the maximum and the minimum. I can press enter here. We have control change. We have aftertouch, as before. But now we have this incremental and decremental. So we'll press enter here. Now here is where we have, of course, the same thing. The machine control right there. It's just two channels now. See that? Okay. And the next parameter here is the NRPN. This depends on your software and how they plan on using it. Now, we can press the preset again, go back to edit, and we have a knob here, K1, K2, and we can change the control change, the aftertouch, and this new thing called the incremental and decremental. Now this all depends on your software, so you really have to check out the software using, whether it's Reasons or Light or whatever you're going to use for your software with your MPK, and find what the manufacturer wants to do with this particular setting, which is the NRPN. Now here in this setting, we can also transmit this data. You can see here, either on the common MIDI channel or 1 through 16 in A and 1 through 16 in B, as before. Move the cursor off again. And here, you can see, this is for the most significant bit of information. And then here, that bank, this is for the least bit of significant information. And we set these fields accordingly. So what happens here is not actually transmitting an absolute value. what it's saying between this increment and that increment is what we're going to actually transmit. But you need to read your manual on the software using, whether it does use NRPN. But if it does, we have it here on an MPK49. Okay, next we're going to cover the buttons. So I hit a button here, hit the S1, S2, or S3, the one of those buttons right there. And I got a button here I'm hitting, and a button on, a button off, a button on. See that? So I hit a button on. And it's cool. So I'll go to edit. I'll hit edit. And these are for the buttons. And now for buttons, we can do a control change. We can also do a program change. So one or two to do. Let's go to control change first. So I'll press enter. And here in enter, we have three of things we can do. Just three things. So here, we can, of course, as always, we can send that MIDI information out. Channel 1 through 16 in A, or 1 through 16 in B, or on the CC, the common MIDI channel. Next. We have here, this is the program change. And that would be whatever program change that that button would affect, would be that particular number, which is 32. Next, we have the toggle. Now here in the toggle, that means that if I hit that button and I press a toggle, that means that the first press lets it output that data of information out. The second press, let's see, it's not zero data. But if it's in the momentary, then hit that data once, that button one time, hit that button again right there, and then bam, you hit it, it's on. I take my finger off, it's off. Let me see that. Now, right here, you'll see the button. I hit the button there, it stops, see? Hit the button, it's lit. Take my finger off, it's not lit. Now, I'm going to go to toggle next. Go back here to toggle. Okay, right here to toggle. And I'll move the toggle. And I hit that button now, and it stays lit. Hit the button again, it cuts off. So I hit it on now, it's saying that it's transmitting that data over that channel, and it's transmitting it at 127, the maximum. And I cut it here, it stops transmitting anything. That's a difference between momentary and toggle. Now, for program change, I'm going to go back here. I'm going to press edit, of course. We got our button here, and we're going to go to program change. Now, I'll press the enter button. And here, of course, we have the MIDI channel to transmit on. We can transmit that channel if we'd like to, or that particular port, whether 1 through 16. In A, or 1 through 16 in B. So that's pretty much similar to what's been happening in all these edit fields. So that's a pretty standard thing, is to transmit the data that we're trying to access. Next, we have the program change field. So this is the program change field right there. See that? So I can pick, I want to change the program. See, I'm playing this keyboard line, and I want to make this module play it too, but with a different keyboard sound. So I'll say, look, I want that particular module to play it at 12. 12 is the bank of keyboard sounds I want it to play. Got that? And then we have our, of course, bank M and bank L. For bank M, for the most amount of bit that it transferred, and bank L for the least amount of bit that it transferred. So we can go to here, see they affect one another. I'm going there to 26, 25, we'll say, and this one, it's maximum. I can go here or there, see that? But they work in conjunction. If I turn this one off, of course, they're both off. And that's for our buttons, S1 through S8. All right, next I want to do the arpeggiator section. So I'm going to press the arpeggiator button down here for a second. I'm going to press edit. Now here we are in the arpeggiator edit section. And we have five different parameters we can actually edit. We have the type, we have the range, the toggle. Let me turn this data wheel one more time. We have the gate and the swing. So we'll start with the type. I'll press edit. And here we have type, which is inclusive here. We have the range, which is zero, and the toggle. So, what happens here in inclusive is that I can hold some keys down. and you hear those keys going back and forth. Now what happens here, the inclusive, is you hear it starts from the bottom. So it plays the bottommost keys first, and the topmost keys next. Now watch, let's search right here. We'll move this back a little bit so you can see this. It's important for you to check it out and see how this works. Now this is inclusive. Here's the bottom note. Here's two notes. Here's three notes. So it plays this one twice and going up. So it's like the bottom note twice, then the top note twice to go up and down. Now go to exclusive, which is the next setting. And here it'll be different. So it starts on top first, see that? The inclusive here stops on the bottom. So this, when it goes to turn back around, it does that. That means if I hit, let's say, more than, let's say, four notes here. One, two, three, four. So it's hitting that bottom note twice. When it gets back to the top, it's top note twice on the way back down. So that means when it gets to the top, it hits the top note again and comes back down at arpeggio. Now, we have random. We can hit these notes here. It'll pick the notes it wants to pick to play as an arpeggiated pattern. Now how this works basically is that we've got set here, as you can see, we've got these buttons here for the time division. Now that was quarter notes. We'll set this one here. That's random. Let's go back down to, this is down, where this goes down, it goes from a down old. I can go to here, to eighth notes. I can go to eighth note triplets. So, the time division allows us to set the timing, the subdivision of the notes. So this is quarter notes, quarter note triplets, eighth notes, eighth note triplets, 16th note, 16th note triplets, 32nd notes, and 32nd note triplets. And that can be set here on our MPK49 using our arpeggiated section. Now, we have the up and the down, so this is the down. Turn it around, we have the up. The next one is up. That's up. Now I can change the range, octave range. We'll go to here, and we'll go to, let's say, plus three. Same notes. Always up. As I change the notes, you'll see here, I can change them. I'll go to this C chord here. That's always up. This one would be down. I go to here, I make it all go down now. Or here. So that's how I change this range, and we have the arpeggiation of the range with random. And there we had also the pitch range. If I can go down in range, I can say I want to do my pitch range. It's either up plus three or zero for the range. Now, what we can also do is change the note length. And I'll change the arpeggiation right here. I'm going to go to, let's see. We want to arpeggiate it now. And next, I'm going to make sure I head to here. We got chord also. Here's chord. I can just hold the chord down. So I can press the chord, say chord here. So you see, I'm holding these chord notes down. As I hold them down, So hitting them as chord, not an arpeggio anymore. It's just you play that chord over and over at the tempo that's selected on your MPK49. And we can change it here, of course, again. I can make it into chord note triplets. So it works pretty accurately, actually.